Good evening. I'm Ashley Berner. I am the Deputy Director of the CUNY Institute for Education. It's my pleasure to welcome you to this historic Roosevelt House and to our discussion of the educational challenges that our undocumented students face and what those challenges mean for education, for policy, and for American civil society. So I hope this will be a rich and lively discussion. And tonight's program will be introduced by Dr. Laura Becker, who is an assistant professor of TESOL at the Hunter College School of Education. However, before we hear from Dr. Becker, we have the privilege of hearing from Assemblyman Francisco Moya. Assemblymember Moya is the first Ecuadorian American to be elected to public office in the United States. He represents the Queens District number 39, and he is the legislative sponsor of New York State's DREAM Act. Originally, we had tried to get his attention for the entire evening, but he has been squeezing us between a press conference and he's wanted in his district by 6:30. So we promised his staff that we would get him out of here as quickly as possible. So please join me in welcoming Assemblymember Moya.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Good evening, everyone. Let me thank the CUNY Institute for Education Policy for hosting this event and really shining a light on the issues that specifically affect the undocumented students, and to Ashley Rogers Berner for your organization's deputy director for inviting me here today to really be part of this wonderful event. Very happy to be here. And the dreamers on this panel who have been brave enough to step out of the shadows and share their stories. As you may know, I am the lead sponsor to the New York State DREAM Act in the state of New York. Usually when I talk about this issue, I'm usually faced with an audience of opposition. So it's good to be here amongst friends and like-minded individuals here. I want to tell you a little story before I go into how the DREAM Act came about and what we've done legislatively. And it's a story of my family. My father immigrated from Ecuador in the early 60s. He was 19 years old, and all he had was this dream to be an architect. And that's all he wanted to do, and he knew that he couldn't do it back home. So he came here with barely no money, didn't know anybody, and tried to enroll in school, and found it very difficult to do so. But in that process, he got drafted. And he was drafted and went to serve in Vietnam for a country that he barely knew, but he knew that this was the only place that was the opportunity to get a good quality education, and then get sent to a country that he didn't know to go fight in a war. The good thing is that he actually scored very high on his IQ. He scored a 170. I wish that I got that that gene. He went to Vietnam, and he came back to New York, in Queens in particular, and the World's Fair was happening. And as we celebrate the 50th anniversary of the World's Fair, that's where he actually met my mother. They knew each other in Ecuador, and they wound up meeting again somehow, God has his plan, and they met at the World's Fair, got married, bought a home in Corona, and if it wasn't for the opportunity that he had through the GI Bill, he would not have been able to go to college. And it's that opportunity that was afforded to him. He worked two jobs. He started off as a clerk in a bank called Bankers Trust, and he sold shoes at night and went to school as well, in a store called Alexander's that no longer exists. And he went to school and he did very well. He graduated with honors, didn't graduate with his degree in architecture, but he went on to be very, very successful in the finance world. He retired a few years ago from Merrill Lynch as one of the VPs there. And instead of retiring and going back to Ecuador or wherever he wanted to retire with my mother, he decided to go back to school and get that degree that he never got. And we're very, very proud of him. And the day that he was to walk again, he couldn't, or he actually chose not to walk on graduation day. Instead, he stood with his son on the corner of 104th Street and Roosevelt Avenue at 6 o'clock in the morning, handing out palm cards on election day. It was the day that I got elected. So you see, it's all about how family and the struggles that we see of our immigrant communities that they had to go through, and our parents and their willingness to do whatever possible to make sure that their children have the opportunities that they never had. You know, I'm not standing here today as an elected official had it not been for that influence, for their ability to make sure that I got a proper education. And so now, when I go around not just the city of New York, but the entire state of New York, talking about the DREAM Act, meeting with DREAMers and their struggles, and when I talk to the opponents who say that, well, illegals, and they use that term illegal as though somehow it's, you know, they're committing a crime. Actually, it's not a crime, but if that's the term that they want to use, we have to learn to educate a lot of these folks. And the problem that we face now is that we have to really go out there and spread the word and let them know that this is about education. This is a civil right for everyone. I've gone throughout the state of New York and I've talked to my Republican colleagues, and I actually went to visit some of them in the southern tier, and then I brought them down to my district and had them meet with DREAMers. And there was not a dry eye in the room when they were able to tell their story. We educate and we pay right now in the state of New York from kindergarten all the way to high school. We pay for public education. To now say to these students who want nothing else but to get a good quality education in the most critical juncture in their academic careers, to say no is just a disservice that we are doing here. It's short-sighted by our government. And one of the things that we have to continue to fight for is to make sure that the DREAM Act becomes a reality. And that's why I'm proud of the work that I've been able to do in educating our folks, but at the same time, making sure that this passes. We had been passing this bill for 3 years in the New York State Assembly. We fell short in the Senate by 2 votes. The majority of senators voted for this. But I think now is the time that we really have to ramp it up a little bit, because we need to make sure that people can call their legislators and tell them that they want to see the DREAM Act passed. That really has a big influence. When DREAMers come up to Albany and have a one-on-one with some member from upstate New York who isn't really used to having the diversity like we have here in New York City, it really sheds light on how they have to be more educated on what we have to do. So we've reintroduced the DREAM Act last week, and we're doing that for a reason. We're doing that because the DREAM Act is not dead. We're going to keep on going. We're going to keep on fighting because it's important. It's important to so that every DREAMer can have that opportunity like my father did. The GI Bill opened that pathway. And that's the thing that we have to never lose focus on, is that you're the future. You're going to be those future legislators, future innovators, that's going to drive the economy in the state of New York and make it this great state that we always looked at. Because New York was always the state that led the way on the most progressive issues across the country. And now we're falling behind. But we have an opportunity. And I'm very hopeful that we take the governor's words and make sure that he lives up to his promise by saying that the DREAM Act is a priority and that we're going to fight for this post-budget. So the fight is not over. I think that we are very, very positive, have a positive outlook of what those next steps are. To me, it's just a great opportunity to be here and share with you my story, but also to tell you that I'm here to support you. We're here to fight to the very end. We will do whatever it takes to make sure that the DREAM Act becomes a reality in the state of New York, because like all of you, I believe in a New York where your immigration status should never be a barrier for young, undocumented students to get a good quality education. So with that, I wish you the best and lots of success tonight. I do apologize that I do have to go back to Queens. I actually have an endorsement hearing that I have to be at, and it is that campaign season that we have to be all over the place, but I would not have missed this for the world, and I'm just very, very excited to have been part of this, and I just really want to thank you all for inviting me here today and listening to my words. Thank you very much. So I just found out news right now of one of my favorite people on the planet, Ted Becker, your husband, my good friend that we used to work together as colleagues in Cablevision. He is one of my dearest, dearest, dearest friends. I love working for him. He's a great man, and please tell him I said hello. All right. Thank you so much. Thank you.
Thank you so much. I managed not to cry through that because I knew I had to come up here because it's such these are such powerful stories, and what you're going to see tonight in this documentary, you might want to get some tissues ready because these are stories that are just profoundly human, and you'll see. I'm so grateful that we were able to bring this event to Roosevelt House. I want to really thank Ashley Berner and Dean Steiner and Jennifer Robb for renovating this beautiful space, and it's wonderful to see so many educators in the room who directly work with students whose lives are really affected by their immigration status. Is Lindsay in here? Lindsay. So one of our Hunter graduates was just telling me upstairs that she had her fifth grade ESL students write stories, family stories, and how many of them wrote about hiding and getting across the border. And she was surprised by those stories. So we have a lot to do as educators to further the mission that we just heard about, because as we reach many, many communities and colleagues, we can do a huge part in educating people about the DREAM Act and have a real voice. So what we're going to experience is the viewing of a documentary created, directed, and co-produced by Dr. Tatiana Klein, who's at City College. On the back of your program, you'll see brief bios about each of our presenters. We're very lucky to have Vivian Louie. She's here on loan to us, I guess, for the year. We're going to keep her, though, in New York City, who is a renowned scholar who's going to provide some historical context for us. We have two of the stars, movie stars, with us, Irving Mota, who is a teacher right now in a dual language program at PS 75, and Jong Min, who himself has a journalist background, so he knows about spreading the word. And we're going to have our discussion facilitated by Ashley Berner. She's the deputy director of the CUNY Institute for Education Policy, and she's a senior fellow at the Center for the Study of Law and Religion at Emory Law School. And she's going to help structure the conversation to hit on social, political, economic, and educational aspects of this very complex issue. So with that, I'm going to have us begin the screening of the film.
When I share my status, people are really surprised, even among other undocumented immigrants. When I tell, for example, coworkers who are undocumented as well, oh, I came when I was 5 months old, they're in shock because I speak English well, or because I went to college, and so forth, and they're just in disbelief. And so, of course, I try to explain to them, well, I came when I was 5 months old, and they're like, oh, you were practically born here. Practically, you know, but that makes a huge difference. You know, those 5 months make all the difference in my life.
I am an African. I am a Malian. I'm a Muslim. And I am a woman.
I would consider myself a very whitewashed Mexican because I am very proud of being Mexican. At the same time, I'm very Americanized and my values are pretty American.
Well, you know,
on the cover of Time magazine. Here I am, right there. That's right there. And I remember being at this photo shoot, and we all had to say, you know, what was our identity? And some of us said, oh, you know, I'm South Korean. And I remember just thinking, you know, I'm an undocumented American. And, you know, this cover says that kind of, I mean, this cover does say that. We are Americans.
Sometimes I consider myself American, but because the country keeps denying me of that right, fully, completely, I am back to not being from here, not being fully Mexican because I'm not there. I don't share a lot of the, you know, things that I'm missing out in back home. So I guess that sometimes I just feel like I'm in that gray area of not knowing what to call myself, but just knowing that I belong, I feel that I belong here.
It all began with my father coming here when I was about 3. Then my mother, my brother, and I decided to cross the border. Well, my parents decided for us, and my mother found a coyote to smuggle us in past the border into the U.S. To me, it was an adventure. Walking through, we crossed to Tijuana. So walking through the valley was like an adventure. Spending a night there was an adventure. We weren't supposed to spend the night there, but because the coyote fell asleep, we missed a ride, so we ended up spending an entire day there. But to me, it was like child's play. Now I look back and I was thinking, I was like, it must have been terribly alarming and like nerve-wracking for my mom to be there with her 2 kids and then some strange man and not know what was going on.
When my mother, my sister, and I crossed, we were in a car. And from what I have been told, we were supposed to be really quiet. Unfortunately, I did not stop crying, but we made it. And so from California or so, we were then transported to New York and reunited with my father.
For some reason, my entire family decided to move to New York. I never really understood why so far and so cold. My dad moved here first. He moved, I think, like 4 years before us, to like come here and make money and stuff, and then my mom decided that we should all be together, so we all moved over.
My family moved to the United States in 1981, so I was about a year old. And they came on student visas, and after about 4 years, those visas expired. And, you know, me and my brother were still here, and so by the time I was 5, I became undocumented.
It wasn't until I reached high school or so that I realized that my status was going to hinder me from reaching my goals and my future, pretty much, because I wanted to go to college, and because of my immigration status, I was not able to pursue those things like the rest of my peers.
I had went to Stuyvesant High School, and when I was a junior, I wanted to do this possible residency program. And so I had gone to the hospital, and the hospital wanted my green card for some sort of reason, and I was like, okay, you know what, I'll just go home and get it. And so I went back to my parents' grocery store, and I asked my mom, I said, where's my green card? And then she says, it's at the house. You know, so I went back home to find this mythical, magical green card, right? And of course, I could never find it after searching. And so I called her back, and I said, where is it? And she says, well, Joma, you don't have one, and you can't tell anybody about this either. And I was like, what are you talking about?
Usually I don't talk about it. Like, I am shy and ashamed of myself, so I don't talk about it to anybody.
I was never really sure up until I think about 5th grade, where some kids were making jokes in class and I didn't really understand it, so I asked my sister and then she explained it to me. She said, like, oh, you're not a legal citizen of this country, and I was like, oh, okay. And it didn't really bother me because I was like 5th grade, so I was like, whatever.
I don't identify just as being an undocumented immigrant, but I feel like that is a big part of who I am. And the fact that I am undocumented has made me the person I am today.
It there's no profile. There's not like one category of people who like are undocumented students. Like, there's just so many of us that you would be surprised. And I don't think people would say I was undocumented just because I was sitting next to them. Like, someone sharing my story sometimes, I would get, well, you don't look undocumented.
Being undocumented is like being in this invisible prison, and you're stuck there behind these invisible bars. And then you see what your friends and peers do, and you want to be a part of that, but you're not. I think you're always reminded that you can't vote and you can't drive. The fear of deportation is really scary, because like they could just kick me out, and my whole life just changed. I have to say, the first time I ever went to look for a job, and I walked into this deli, and he was like, so do you have working papers? And I was like, oh, well, no, because, and I explained everything. He was like, oh, I can't give you the job. And I had to be, like, not getting a job, like, solely because of that reason. It had to be one of the most discouraging things. Like, I just went straight home after that.
It's hard enough being the first person in your family going to college, but it makes it 20 times harder when you're the first one and you're undocumented, and there's literally nobody to tell you left from right, or up and down, or what's the process that you're supposed to do as far as college goes.
For a very long time in my life, I was really scared to tell other people about my status as an undocumented immigrant. But later on, I realized that by being open, you feel empowered, and you get to share knowledge to other people, because a lot of misconceptions are out there.
There's a lot of undocumented students in high schools, and quite frankly, according to statistics, 65,000 immigrants without documents like myself graduate every year. 65,000.
I believe the biggest misconception is that we don't pay taxes, we're here to mooch off the system, and we don't contribute at all. And there's so many of us that pay taxes, income taxes, state taxes. You know, we have an ITIN number, individual tax ID number, which allows us, even if we don't have social security numbers, to pay taxes to the federal government.
Not every undocumented immigrant cleans bathrooms and mows lawns. My uncle actually works as like a manager of a plant, and my dad has his own little business where he does like handiwork and stuff, and he's very skilled.
Well, I believe that a lot of people think it's just a Latino issue, a Mexican issue, and I'm proof that it's not. And so when you have all these people who are from Asia, from Europe, and from Africa as well, it's a global issue that affects all of us.
I get a kick out of hearing the reactions that people tell me, because they usually go, oh, where are you from? Well, what do you mean? Where are we from? It's like, oh, I'm Mexican. Oh, you're Mexican? Oh, you don't look Mexican. Not that I don't know what a Mexican is supposed to look like, but that's usually how it goes. And then later on, I'll be like, oh, yeah, I'm undocumented. No, you're not. I'm like, yes, I am.
Some of them kind of assume that I am undocumented once they find out that I am Mexican. It's like, oh, okay, you know, you're Mexican. So of course you have to be undocumented.
I told my situation to one of my college supervisors, and she was more than helpful and everything, but I own an iPad, and I found it really funny that she related. She's like, you're undocumented, but you own an iPad.
I think that as teachers and guidance counselors, they should always have high standards for all students, regardless of their immigration status. So I know that many times we don't feel comfortable sharing our immigration status for fear, for shame, for different reasons. However, as guidance counselors and as teachers, our jobs, or their jobs, is to provide the information. And right now in New York, there's a lot of immigrants in New York, right? So why not look for those resources and provide them to all your students? Everyone should have access to education, and here in New York, we are also have the chance to have access to that education. In state tuition, we are able to go to SUNY and CUNY colleges, even some private colleges as well, a privilege that many other students in other states don't have.
I would suggest to get involved in any community service projects that they can get in, because quite frankly, a lot of private scholarships reward students for such involvement.
One of the biggest things that I've kind of seen, I think was kind of noticeable, is the Drop the I Word campaign. And you know, sometimes I think how we use words, you know, illegal versus undocumented, it can and does have a negative effect. You say, you know, you're illegal, you know, all these illegal immigrants should get out of here, and why are they here? And I think just be careful and noticing how they use these words and in the context they do it as well.
There's different support systems. One, obviously, is my family, who's been there supporting me throughout the decisions that I've made. Other, it's the group that I'm involved with. The name is the New York State Youth Leadership Council. So it's an undocumented youth led organization. When I found out about them, I had graduated from high school, so I was kind of lost. I didn't know where to go. And I ended up meeting many of the members at the time, and they were also undocumented like I am.
Don't waste the opportunity you have, because your parents sacrificed a lot. Like my parents sacrificed a lot to come here. And if you just drop out of high school or do bad in high school, you're just wasting like a giant opportunity that you wouldn't have had back in your other country. You know, there's so many of us that want to contribute and give back to society. And we technically can't right now, but we're trying and we're pushing for it.
Under this program, we can also receive driver's license, which is great news. But at the end of the road, there is still one problem. We are still undocumented. We still don't have a legal status. And so the ultimate solution for this dilemma would be the DREAM Act.
I think another misconception that needs to be addressed is that even a lot of senators that are in favor of the DREAM Act, the Development Relief Education for Alien Minors Act, is that the parents are the criminals. This is always brought up even by senators that, according to them, support the DREAM Act. And so it's believed that the criminals are the parents. But as I've always defended my parents, saying my parents are not criminals because survival is not a crime. I used to work in Brooklyn, and I lived in the Bronx, and I went to school in Manhattan. One occasion, I was at work, and we closed like at 2 o'clock in the morning, and then we still had to clean, so I got out like at 3. And so I'm sitting there waiting for the train to come and take me home, and I was thinking about the homework that I still had to complete. And I thought to myself, I'm still waiting for something to come, and it's not just a train. I'm waiting for some type of change to take place. And so I sat there and I tried not to cry because I thought about all of those things. But at the same time, you need to start thinking about the positive things as well. To think that at the end it's all going to be worth it, not only in my life, but in the life of so many undocumented students as well, who very much deserve to experience that change.
something? What did you learn?
About college.
And what are you going to do when you go to college? What are you going to study?
I'm going to study math, writing, homework.
And do you see that because you were born here, you have a lot of privileges that your sister doesn't have?
Yeah.
So that kind of means you have to take every advantage and be maybe the president of the college, and maybe you could live in that building, okay?
That building?
Perhaps. Would you like to?
That's college.
Okay. Anything else you want to say to the people of this country?
I love you.
I think they're going to love you too.
Well, thank you so much for introducing the film in the evening, and we're fortunate to have two dreamers here and the film's director and producer. So my first question, before we delve into the political and educational aspects, is the personal one. Very briefly, Tatiana, would you tell us how you came to make this film and what its impact has been?
Sure. So this film was actually premiered about a year ago. So since then, it's been quite a journey. It was May 2nd. It was the day after May Day when I was doing a panel for the New York City Department of Education, the Office of English Learners. And they mic you, and they bring in a filmmaker. And I never really know what happens to these films, but they film you. And afterwards, the filmmaker, we had Am Jong Min was there. We had a panel of dreamers. We did it on immigration, and the filmmaker came up to me and he said, you know, I'd love to work with you and do something on this. I'd love to work with you pro bono. And I was like, wow, film, like that's a new world to me. Let's do it. And I thought he was just going to take our panel and just cut it up and put it on YouTube, and I thought that would be great, and I was really excited about that. But then he's like, no, I want to like do something like from scratch. And that to me was like, wow. So we got together. I think we were in a cafe in Brooklyn, and we started talking about what's needed. And there was already a lot about the DREAM Act, and we could have done more, but I think it was Irving and Arlene from the film talked about their high school experiences. And you know, when I was in high school, I spoke to a guidance counselor, but they tried to help, but they didn't know which direction to put me in. Or I was too shy or ashamed to tell someone I didn't have a relationship with anyone, I didn't know who to talk to. So we said, you know what, let's make a film that can be shown in our dream, right, in every high school class or even middle school, so that all students could see the realities of what it's like to be undocumented, and those who are undocumented could say, okay, now I know what the information is. Because as teachers, we're always trying to inform ourselves, but with immigration, these things change by the minute, and so it's so hard, and there's a DREAM Act, and there's a DREAM Fund, and what's here or there. Mm-hmm. So we really made this as a tool for educators, but we've realized it's much more than a tool for educators. It's for guidance counselors, for principals, for parents at the elementary school level to see that their kids, too, can go to college. We developed a lesson plan that actually Irving developed. It's if you got the blue packet, there's a resource guide to go with it. So it's really a tool to educate everyone. So we're really thrilled that it was shown here today.
And speaking of the changing landscape, can you all give us a picture of this DREAM Act in New York versus the DREAM Acts that are enacted in other states and what's actually possible here for undocumented studies?
Okay, I'll go. Francisco Moya has been great in trying to push the New York DREAM Act. California has their own DREAM Act, which gives financial access to undocumented students so that they could go to college. Unfortunately, New York has yet to be there. I know that maybe Oklahoma actually gives another financial access. There's about 16 states that give in-state tuition, but there's only so many handfuls that give financial access, and that's so important for students like me. Well, actually, I graduated college 11 years ago, but you know, for me to try to go back to graduate school, I think that would be really important for me. I think the difference between that and the federal DREAM Act is citizenship. Pathway to citizenship, trying to get our papers to vote and to actually become a federal judge or to, you know, to do things that we want to do. And so I think that's where the difference lies. I think New York can do it this year, and hopefully they will. And I know that the comprehensive bill, unfortunately, that's kind of bleak right now. And so I think we have to push for that as well, not just for us, but for our parents and for all the day laborers out there and all the undocumented students and even the kids that cross the border, and hopefully they can have some status as well.
So currently, New York State allows in-state tuition for undocumented students, correct? Is there any concern around the country from one state to the other that having the possibility of state funding would encourage undocumented students to come from other states? Mm-hmm. And has there been any documentation of this happening?
You just don't get in-state tuition just by coming into the state. There's mm-hmm. actually there are certain requirements for you to qualify for in-state tuition. Recently, though, For example, in the state of New York, you need to be a graduate of high school mm-hmm. in the state of New York, or you need to have gotten your GED from the state of New York, and you need to sign an affidavit that declares that you are undocumented and that you will do your best to have your situation resolved as soon as you can. So it's not just open to anybody. So if people coming in from any other state would not have in-state tuition here in New York. And the one state that I recently read that just added in-state tuition is Florida, which is incredible because it's mm-hmm. one of the states that also has a high immigrant population, and for it not to be a state that has the services to its students is shocking. And John mm-hmm. Ming spoke to, like, there's a big difference between the federal government, the federal DREAM Act, and each state DREAM Act. But if the federal DREAM Act were to go through, then these state-to-state DREAM Acts would not be necessary. So the people mm-hmm. who are actually advocating and moving for these state DREAM Acts are actually, I think, contributing to a larger picture.
Mm-hmm. And what about the role of military service? Is there some role that military service plays in receiving tuition?
To my understanding, military service is only, you're only allowed to be in the military if you're a resident or a U.S. citizen. So anybody under DACA, I believe, recently, I'm not too knowledgeable about that, but mm-hmm. as far as financial aid for mm-hmm. college, I think it's only if you are a resident or a citizen.
I think Francis Camoyo talked about the GI Bill his father was under. There's nothing like that for the undocumented population. I think they were rallying for that just this past week, and unfortunately, the defense bill, they shut it out, and so DREAMers can't be in the military as of this moment trying to participate. So unless the federal bill passes, then maybe they could participate and mm-hmm. serve the country or get an education.
Mm-hmm. And deferred action has given a lot of, has opened a lot of opportunities for a lot of undocumented youth. And
like yourself.
Like myself. But there are still many, many, many of us that even with deferred action aren't able to do what we love and carry out our careers and, you know, go live the lives that we dream. Like, we're still very limited.
And the deferred action gives you a 2-year window, is that right? And then you have to reapply. And how onerous is that to reapply?
As long as there was no change in your conduct, then, you know, you still remain with a clean record, like there mm-hmm. are only less than 3 misdemeanors and no felonies, mm-hmm. You're able to get it back. But to be honest with you, I think the wave of DREAMers are applying to renew the deferred action is just about to start, pretty much, mm-hmm. because it's been less than 2 years. In 2012, it was approved in June. I remember it was a few days after my graduation, because graduation was very bittersweet for me. And it wasn't until late August that they started taking in applications. Mm-hmm. So it'll be 2 years soon. So I think if anybody, there's just applications are being processed now. And as to like the statistics of people who are getting that 2-year mm-hmm. renewal, it's going to be maybe coming out soon. But there's mm-hmm. not, hasn't been anybody yet that I know of.
Well, actually, it hasn't opened yet. They're actually kind of opening the process, I think, later this month or early next month. And so it's about 3 to 4 months before the renewal period that people can actually see the guidelines and apply for it again. Unfortunately, because I'm so old, I don't have deferred action. And you know, I graduated college 11 years ago. And so the thing is, you know, even 2 years ago, I've tried to work on deferred action for the older DREAMers. And I've actually saw all the cracks, people that don't even have 5 years. Because there's, you know, you got to be under 31, you got to be here 5 years. And I saw all these kids, and I was just pushing everybody to do it for this year. And hopefully we could actually sit down at the table and try to have deferred action for other kids or, you know, even older people so mm-hmm. that, you know, because here's another thing about the Federal DREAM Act is that if you're on this pathway to citizenship, they don't have that much momentum to deport you. I mean, even though citizens have been erroneously deported, I think it gives, you know, the safety net for our parents as well right. to be safe from deportation. And I think that's what so many of us fight, like on the side. You know, mm-hmm. we have to go to school. You know, your kids go to school and then they worry about their parents being, you know, picked up while driving because they don't mm-hmm. have licenses. And so I think that's always a thing that we have to work on as well.
These are some of the educational concerns that teachers of undocumented students must deal with on a daily basis. The awareness of these stressors that are in the background. So let's talk a little bit about the opposition to the DREAM Act. The Siena poll that was released in March, right before the vote, showed that opposition in New York State was actually increasing. I think 56% of New Yorkers were on record as being opposed, and that was actually up from 53% in January. Let me just read some quotations here. I think from what it seems to me, the opposition comes from an economic perspective. You know, we can't afford to do this. And it also comes from almost a personal fairness side, that I paid for my college education, why should someone else not have to? So let me just read some examples of these. This is a statement from March from New York Senator Lee Zeldin, who's in Long Island. And after affirming the role that immigration plays in this country's history, he says, "After hearing from constituents, educators, and these students themselves, it is clear that our system is broken and it's failing them. I admire the passion of the students who have told their stories, and I have the utmost respect for their desire to continue their education. That being said, I cannot in good conscience support expanding eligibility for state financial aid to undocumented immigrants at the expense of citizens and other immigrants who are here lawfully." So that's from Senator Zeldin. Now this is a more personal objection. This is from Rebecca Schumann, who writes for the International Business Times. This is also in March. "Every semester throughout my 4 years of college, I was laughed out of the financial aid office for requesting assistance from the government. I resorted to applying for student loans, and I gratefully accepted them when they were approved. Now, after spending myself countless thousands on my higher education, I find myself struggling to embrace New York's latest tuition assistance program, the New York State DREAM Act. According to the New York State Youth Leadership Council, New York residents should pay a dollar a day to support the quality of life for those who are not legally supposed to be here. If you want to get an education in the U.S., don't take it from the paycheck that I earned because I paid for 4 years of college." So those are fairly representative examples of what the DREAM Act faces in this state. So I'd like to hear from Vivian. What should we make of these sentiments? Are these arguments distinctive in any way from the nativist movements that we've had in the past, from the 19th century, from the early 20th century? How can we engage with these arguments, and what do they tell us about our country at this moment?
Thank you, Ashley. And I just wanted to say thank you for the invitation to be on this wonderful panel. And Tatiana's film is just amazing. And Irving and Jomin, it's just a privilege to join, and Laura, to join you all today. It's such an important contribution. And in answer to your important question, I mean, definitely, I just want to say that immigration, of course, has been critical, integral, to the development of the United States as a nation, and also to the public educational system. And that nativist movements, of course, have also accompanied the arrivals of immigrants historically, as well as into the post-1965 era in which we're currently situated. They typically come during times of economic crisis, right? And it's also about the issue of whether immigrants can, and their children, can assimilate, become American. The idea of what are their economic contributions, whether they're undocumented or documented. I mean, that's historically been the case. But the thing is that America has been built on the contributions of immigrants historically and into today. And so in response to those questions, My answer would be basically that what the historical record has shown, and we certainly have every expectation that the future record will show this, although I'm not a pundit, is that basically the contributions of immigrants and their children are really foundational to America at large, to who we are as a nation, but our economic well-being. It's, you know, the retirement, our retirement is basically going to be built on the educational and labor market contributions of the children of immigrants.
And this has something to do with the demographic bulge that is coming in our country, correct?
Absolutely.
So what can we say, what can you all say about the economic arguments that were made? That this, we can't afford this, this is too expensive.
I think we can make holes in those arguments.
Just give us the very quick
I think just looking at what studies have shown is that undocumented immigrants contribute more in the tax dollars that we showed in the film than they actually take back. Mm-hmm. So they're already, so just that. Another way to look at it is by investing in our undocumented students, they will give back to our society. So look at Irving. He, because he's in New York State and he is now documented, he can now be a New York City public school teacher, a bilingual school teacher, a teaching certification area where we have a shortage, where we have people that can do this, but we're looking everywhere and anywhere for people that are bilingual, multicultural, et cetera. So I think it has to be a long, we have to look at this in the long term, not just, okay, we're paying them now, but how is this gonna affect our society, our state, and our country over time? Mm-hmm.
And as far as those sort of negative viewpoints that I read, have you all experienced that personally? And when you go into those conversations, what can you affirm? What can you push back on? What's the best, how do you negotiate those conversations? And what happens? Do you change anyone's mind?
I don't think that's an easy conversation to have with anybody, especially when they bring up viewpoints such as the ones you just mentioned. When I found myself in situations like that, I always just try to share my story and say that I was able to go to college thanks to the help of my parents and paying for college out of my parents' pocket. But at the same time, I feel that when people come to the table with that mentality, it's kind of very hard to change it. So I don't go enter the conversation with the mindset that I'm here to change your mentality. I'm just here to expand your horizons and show you that there's more to the picture than what you know. Mm-hmm. And I find it that I get more positive feedback taking that approach. Mm-hmm. Versus going into it that I'm here to change your mind and I'm going to show you that you're wrong for viewing things this way, but more so just I'm giving you new information and something you might not be so knowledgeable on, and giving you the other side of the coin.
Mm-hmm. That's good. You know, sometimes like being Asian, we're not exactly there. You know, there's Jose Antonio Vargas, and you know that's him. But
do you want to tell him what he is?
Yeah, Jose Antonio Vargas is he's undocumented. He actually on the Time magazine cover. He invited all of us there, and he's made a film documented. And so he's been a well-known advocate. He spoke on Capitol Hill. So, but the thing is, like, I went to City Hall and I talked about the DREAM Act, and then you know my face was in a Korean newspaper, and there's always all these Koreans, and there's a backlash against Asian activism, and I think that me trying to talk back about this because, you know, there's some, you know, 1 in 5 Koreans are undocumented, right? And so, you know, that's so such a high percentage. And I felt that there was a need for me to come back, even age of 30-ish something, and to come back and, you know, to come back and say, look, you know, we're here. You know, my family has been here 30 years and they still don't have status. And I feel like it's just such a shame. And I feel like I had to push it for them, and even when I testified on the municipal ID, New York State is trying to have a municipal ID for like the undocumented residents for all state of New York. You know, when I talked about that, I hope that my parents would be supportive. But you know, I think sometimes my mom is very, you know, very careful, and and I think there's some talk about that. But I think it's so important when we're in the newspapers and media that they say, "Wow, you know, I think this is such a great thing," and I think we need to push it so that other people could come out and be at least somewhat, you know, out there. But I think the ironic thing is if you're more out there, the less the likely they'll report you.
Vivian, is there an historical trajectory that you can point to in terms of non-immigrants becoming convinced of a certain salience to an issue?
Sure, but before I get to that, I just wanted to build on Joan's very valuable points about Asian Americans, and also to say that Mr. Vargas is a Pulitzer Prize winning journalist, right? So for him to kind of come out from under the shed and say, hey, I'm undocumented, I've been here since a young age, I've reached the heights of my profession as a journalist, I've, you know, won the Pulitzer Prize, but this is who I am, right? This is what my status is. And also to say that, yes, that Asian Americans are also part of the undocumented population, although there's a lot of reserve within the population as well. But we know from the pioneering work of Peter Kwong, who's a distinguished professor at Hunter, about the arrivals of undocumented Chinese immigrants with the Golden Venture, which ran aground in New York City about a little bit over more than 20 years ago. And then getting to your question about the whole issue of the issue of non-immigrants, right, mm-hmm. coming round to, mm-hmm. is that right? So, no, definitely. And I think that, you know, in America, we've shown that we can do that, and we have done that. I think part of what we need to be thinking about, though, is the stories that we tell about ourselves as a nation and as a nation mm-hmm. of immigrants. This idea that earlier waves of immigrants who came to the United States, who are, of course, from Southern, Central, and Eastern Europe, from the mid-19th century into 1924, somehow came mm-hmm. and rose, you know, hard work and effort, and it was a miraculous rise. But actually, we know from the work of Richard Alba and Nancy Boner, it took several generations for that to happen. Educational progress was incremental. And it wasn't as rosy as the picture. They faced huge amounts of exclusionary barriers, discrimination, xenophobia. Mm-hmm. So that's the part of the story that we need to be thinking mm-hmm. about, and the importance of institutional mechanisms for success. And it's basically what Tatiana opened with, that this film is a learning tool, right, as to share information and to put the word out there.
Yeah. Well, actually, Vivian, that was one thing that you did say in your book, is that previous waves of immigrants could take, well, not could, but usually took 3 to 4 generations to accomplish what you all are having to do in one generation. So if you want to say something briefly about that context, the economic realities.
Absolutely, and I think that's just such a huge point that we have to be keeping in mind, right, is that before the 1960s, you could actually take a family several generations. College was not as important to having a middle-class life, to getting a good job with benefits, as it is today in the United States and globally increasingly. And so what that means is that children from families where the parents don't have a college education, they have a single generation to make it to college. We're asking quite a lot of those mm-hmm. children mm-hmm. across the board. So when we think about the contributions with DACA and the DREAM Act and the like, we're thinking not just about the benefits to an individual, mm-hmm. to the family to which that individual belongs, or even to the group to which that individual and family belong, but to our national well-being.
Mm-hmm. Tatiana, did you have a comment?
I just wanted to go back to the point about how do we bring non-immigrants in on this, but I want to just complicate it a little bit and to say that not all immigrants are in favor of these reforms either, right? So we have very short memories. People, well, I came legally. I can even say from my own family's perspective, I'm not going to name names. You know, we came this way, why can't they, et cetera. Mm-hmm. So I think it also goes back to how we educate our students. Mm-hmm. So it's about, not about, okay, this is the only way, but it's about showing them multiple perspectives mm-hmm. and stories and realities. So that's why I'm so glad there's so many educators in the room, because we have to tell these stories. And, mm-hmm. you know, I was just talking to people before, like, we can't just talk about Ellis Island. Right, we have mm-hmm. to go beyond that and look at the current realities, but that's mm-hmm. from the work I've seen in schools, it's the way that we teach about immigration. Not just teaching immigration is not enough, but how we teach it.
Well, yes. let's switch to education in general and immigrants in education. And during this next few minutes. If you all have questions for the panel, if you want to write them on your question cards and pass them to the end, and my MCSIC, our equity fellow, will come around and collect them. So Vivian's book, which I have here and which will be downstairs, or upstairs rather, Keeping the Immigrant Bargain, you identify some of the mechanisms for success, the social capital that seems to make a difference for first-generation immigrants, whether documented or undocumented. Can you say a few things about social capital and what you found?
Absolutely, Ashley. So social capital, simply defined, is the information that you get from the people whom you know, or your social networks. And then the extent to which you can use that information for a positive outcome. For example, for first-generation immigrant parents to learn about the public educational system, which educates most Americans today. And so basically what the research has shown about social capital, and this research has shown it to be true, that you really need abundant sources of social capital to become successful. And you need those abundant sources of social capital to learn about institutional supports, like federal TRIO programs, Upward Bound, which was born during President Lyndon Baines Johnson's Great War on Poverty, right, which is celebrating its 50th anniversary today. Other kinds of bridge programs that are modeled on Upward Bound that provide college assistance, SAT test prep, right? How do you advocate for your child? What courses should your children be taking? I mean, these are important things that everyone needs to know, especially if you come from a working class or poor family background, regardless of whether you're an immigrant or not. Mm-hmm. And the research on the children of immigrants has clearly shown the power of social capital to their moving ahead, and the more recent research about the undocumented children shows the same thing.
Right, so institutional supports that make a difference. For Jongmin and Irving, very briefly, what are some institutional supports in high school that made a difference for you?
Well, I went to high school in 94, so. The DREAM Act was introduced in 2001, so that doesn't really apply now. But I think that, I hope that, you know, maybe I should go back to Stuyvesant and talk to them if they want to have me. And I'd be willing to talk to the kids now at Stuyvesant. I think they need it. I think everybody needs it, actually. And hopefully that, you know, but I want to go off on a little tangent as well. You know, I think that one of the cultural issues about Asian Americans is that there's this secrecy. And I think that's one of the factors that play into it.
Secrecy around what?
You know, you don't want to put your dirty laundry in public. Mm-hmm. And so I think this undocumented status plays into that. Mm-hmm. I think sometimes it causes, like, depression. And I hope that if I go to high schools, mental health counselors will recognize this as well, guidance counselors, so that, you know, these kids who may have some symptoms of this can get the help that they need and have support systems as well.
Mm-hmm. So this is back to educating educators about those factors that pertain. Irving?
And my experience was, I received, I lived both ends of the spectrum because I went to high school I went to two separate high schools. So I was in one high school up until my junior year, and then my senior year I transferred. The first high school that I went to, I can say that, to be honest with you, I don't believe the counselor who was helping me had the resources to guide me. Mm-hmm. I do agree with Jongmin. There is a fear of the unknown and a fear of sharing our legal status, and that primarily comes from the fear that we're going to get deported and that our family is going to be affected if you speak out and if you share who you are. So I can say that you wouldn't have people sharing their legal status with many. I shared it because I always knew that I wanted to go to college, but I found that my first experience sharing it, it was just me getting shut down. Mm-hmm. I was told that college for me would not be a likelihood because of my legal status, and that I should opt for something more like a technical school or like something short and quick.
So the undermatching problem.
The undermatching. Yeah. And not because I was the best student. I have been a good student all my academic career, not the best, but good standing. And it was very disheartening for me to hear that, because here I am and you're telling me that I have to stop, give up on something, and just settle for something else. Mm-hmm. So, needless to say, I never went back to my guidance counselor after that.
The one with the iPad?
Don't go there.
And then my senior year, we ended up relocating, and thankfully I landed in the hands of somebody who just was not afraid to say, I don't know, but I'm going to find out. Mm-hmm. And I'm so thankful for being placed in Ms. Peterson, how I'm always going to remember her, because she was just amazing. And I spoke to her, and she's like, you know what, like, this is the first time I see this, and like, I don't know what to do, I don't know what to tell you. And that to me was just more comforting than telling me to offer mm-hmm. something else just because you don't know the answer to something. And she got back to me a month later, she saw me in the hallway, she's like, I'm still working on it, and so she finally did. And she reached out to colleague, and so she had an answer for me, and she's like, you know what, you can go. It's not going to be easy, but we're going to work through it, and we're going to do this. And then she was just like the light at the end of the tunnel. And I think mm-hmm. as educators, being that light for mm-hmm. somebody who wants to go to college, it's such a huge, makes a huge difference. And you can change somebody's life, because I believe that like undocumented students do want to go to college, but some of us already have the misconception that we can't. So we give up even before we begin the journey.
Right.
Mm-hmm. And that is where like the change needs to be made.
So this is something that Vivian calls sort of advantageous relationships with adults, and how can we maximize the chance of students whose parents are undocumented as well, having those successful and supportive relationships. Tatiana, do you want to say something about your work going around schools and talking about this?
We've shown this film, since it's come out, 20 times. In schools, conferences, bookstores, professional development, et cetera. But we had one experience in Brooklyn Collaborative High School where there was a girl, and she had her head down. I remember her very clearly because she had blue hair. So she stood out a little bit. And I just thought, like, as a teacher, I wanted to be like, sit up, look up, you know. But I was a guest, so I just kind of laid back. And afterwards, I went into the restroom, and as I kind of saw her at the corner of my eye, and she was just bawling. And then I was like, oh my goodness. So I said something to her teacher, and she talked to her, and she said that she was undocumented, and that was the first time that she had heard this conversation in school, and saw Jungman and Irving were actually mm-hmm. both there. Well, to bring this kind of semi-full circle, the school came back. They said, we want to show the film again to the 11th graders this year. Mm-hmm. They actually came to City College, and mm-hmm. Lupe is now a leader in this movement, and she was actually on our panel. This time with pink hair. so that was really powerful. One other, one of the most touching moments to me was when we showed this in Children's Village. Has anyone heard of Children's Village in Dobbs Ferry? It is an undocumented minor center where they are detained. If they are caught either at the border or they're living here and caught in an offense, and they sit there and they are basically prisoners in some way, although they give them great resources and education until their cases are heard or they find someone for them to stay with. And one of my former students, Adalberto Munoz, is a teacher there, and we decided to show the film there. But I was very unsure because these are students like that are looking at other dreamers but who are free, who are in school. A lot of these young children who cross the border, especially teenagers, they have very low formal education, right? So their literacy skills are still developing. So I'm like, I don't know, we're showing them this film about you can go to college, and some of them have a third grade education or a sixth grade. I really was unsure about showing this film, but their reaction was so positive. And I was thinking, why? Because for many of these students, college is really would be a real stretch. Even a GED would be a stretch. But it was because it was the first time that they saw people like them who are undocumented in a positive light. Because if you turn on any TV and you listen to what they're saying about immigrants, especially undocumented immigrants, it is so negative. And they're in these immigration cases and courts, and they're detained. And so that to me was just, so it didn't matter like that they couldn't maybe reach these same levels, but that they could see people who look like them doing positive things and in that light. So that to me was really
powerful. And let me just say also that Tatiana has written a guide for teenagers that is used for schools, and she'll be signing this afterwards, as will Vivian. We have about 7 minutes for audience questions, so I'm going to need to ask you in your responses to be very, very brief. All right? These are very interesting questions. First of all, what's the role of the private sector in providing financial aid and support for immigration reform and for undocumented and first-generation students? Is the private sector engaged in this? If not, why not?
Mark Zuckerberg is. Some of the private sector has a real interest in these issues because they are looking at immigrants who have certain degrees or engineering or technology backgrounds, so they want them as well. They're not; they may have different rationales, but they're interested in it. There are private scholarships. Undocumented students can qualify for private scholarships. We have them in the resource guide. I don't know if you guys want to say anything else.
Okay. This is a question about research, financial research on the consequences of the DREAM Act in different states. You mentioned that California, among others, has passed its own DREAM Act. Has there been any research on the budgetary impacts?
There was research. I'm exactly hazy on that because I don't exactly know. But I think the thing was they paid more taxes than they gave out. And I think it costed 20 some millions. And I think it just benefited the whole state. I think California, let's try to piggyback a little bit. California has the first undocumented lawyer. So not only can you go to college, let's go to grad school and become a lawyer. And I think Florida has the second one. And I think New York is trying to have the third one. And I think that by giving them access to this numbers, games, and tax money, I think then they could actually move up in society and become productive.
Anything, Tatiana?
The studies about DACA have shown that the majority of students are now able to get their first jobs, have a driver's license, which in New York City is not that big of a deal, but as soon as you leave New York City, try going to school or a job and waiting for these buses that come once every 5 hours, opening their first bank account and getting their first credit card, which is a good and a bad, right?
Okay, yeah. So there's a related question. What job opportunities are there for undocumented students if you're not eligible for DACA?
Myself, being undocumented up until a little more than a year ago, I had to work in jobs that would give me the opportunity to work being undocumented, jobs primarily that would just pay off the books. That was like the only job, which is very limited, very, very limited, because perhaps a few years back, more employers were willing to pay off the books, but with time, that's become less and less, and you don't go into a job telling them, can I get paid off the books for X, Y, and Z?
Right, there's a risk involved, I would think.
Of course, yes. I would always approach them and say, like, so what's the possibility of just getting paid off the books? It just would make it a lot more convenient. You have to try to be very nonchalant and kind of build a whole, like, speech that will kind of go along with it and just kind of ease your way into it. And if they say no, then, you have to kind of very discreetly withdraw your application and go somewhere else because you obviously don't want to drag too much attention to yourself.
So but if the you're job, not eligible under DACA, then there's essentially nothing
there's
one
essentially
can do.
You could be a very skilled worker and you could have you could be certified to do a lot more, but you could be limited to working. Not that there's anything wrong, because I did this for all my college years. I worked in restaurants and I bartended, and there are people who have degrees already and aren't able to exercise them, and that's just, it's very, very sad.
I think, let me try to pick up. I did the construction work as well, but the fact is, like, if you're an entrepreneur, you can have your own business, and actually, Jose Antonio Vargas has his own company, and you could actually own your own business and sell your goods, paintings or books or songs or DJing, and I think that's a way for these undocumented immigrants who don't have DACA, or anybody in general, to give back to society and pay those taxes to the federal government.
Okay, this is going to be our last question. This is for an educational question. This is from an educator. I find it challenging to engage the parents of undocumented students. They're often afraid to provide information for their children. So, for example, income information for the FAFSA application for college. So what, anyone want to comment on that? And how educators can deal with parents and perhaps create a good environment?
Are undocumented immigrants eligible for FAFSA?
No.
I don't think so, no.
No.
That's probably
wrong. I think, speaking to that, I want to say that I think John will agree with me. I think parents are usually very hesitant to have their children speak up about the legal status for the fear of being deported and for the fear of Child Protective Services being involved. There's a lot of misconceptions that parents have as to what teachers are able to do or not do for their students. my parents always like valued the education system here and the support the teachers gave us, but at the same time they feared it because they knew that if anything were to look wrong, the light could be put on them and then fear of getting us taken away from them. So I think you have to be very delicate and very careful as you approach the parents. I think the best way to do it would be in just to try to like, you know, let them know that you're there to help them mm-hmm. and explain the situation, why the benefits of this would be. And most likely they're not providing you when you want to apply for FAFSA because they most likely don't have a social security number and they know that it's going to be thrown back and that's going to put their child in a uncomfortable situation. So they're just usually trying to avoid being put
right.
in a
I'm very struck by the story that Jungmin told in the film about the green card, for example.
Yeah.
We don't have one, which you hadn't known until that moment.
But, you know, I was 17 as well.
Mm-hmm.
You know, but let me, California has Medi-Cal, and so undocumented immigrants there can actually apply for health insurance. And so what they found was that the parents didn't want to give out their information because they were afraid as well. So that was kind of interesting because, you know, this was health insurance by the government, but, we can't do that. I think what's interesting is that if they're not eligible FAFSA, they're not going to apply. But if they could apply for DACA, I think that would be the push that educators should give them so that, you know, these kids now, they could actually have a job, a summer job, internship, so that they could actually afford other things. And
mm-hmm.
I think that's the push that, you know, just saying that we're not immigration, we're here to help you, you know,
mm-hmm.
I think this is, like, our story and this is how we perceive it. You know, like, certain universities have stepped in for those kids who have been in deportation
mm-hmm.
proceedings, and if they could rally around the student body and have some DREAM Act clubs there, I think that would be a great thing to do.
Well, I think at this point we're going to take the conversation upstairs. We'll have a reception waiting for us, and you'll have a chance to engage with the panelists. And also, we have some books by Vivian Louie and also by Tatiana, and they will be available to sign copies. So thank you all for joining us, and thank you all for engaging in this important topic.